last presentation before we go on to hear the tape from Lynn and questions with Helga and for the panel is from Gerry Rose. Gerry is going to speak on some of the beasts and crawling insects and things that are out there crawling around the American.
I ask you not to comment.
I won't comment either. If civilization is to survive, by next year, Lyndon LaRouche will be out of jail and on his way to the White House. Now, how is this result possible? There are two parts to this proposition. First is the issue of civilization's survival. As we have referred to in the previous panels, we're witnessing the most gigantic genocide in history. That is not an accident. It is because George Bush and the people behind him want it this way. This was implicit in national security document, which we uncovered, entitled NSSM 200. And in an upcoming book, we shall document in great detail that the Bush family, and most emphatically Prescott Bush, along with Averell Harriman, actually taught the Nazis eugenics. It was they who not only invited Ernst Rudin and other Nazi Party officials to the first Congress on Eugenics in August of 1932, but arranged through the Bush-Walker shipping lines to bring them over. At the meeting, Rudin was elected the president of the International Federation of Eugenics Society. It was Rudin who wrote the Nazi laws on sterilization. Not only was Prescott Bush a fanatical eugenicist, but he, along with Averell Harriman, were the sole business partners of the Nazis during the entirety of World War II, and were one-third owners of the Union Bank when the Nazi Party owned the other two-thirds. So there was no mistake when George Bush in 1969 invited William Shockley to address the Republican Task Force on Earth Resources and Population. In the 1960s, Shockley was famous for statements like this, quote, "If those blacks with the least Caucasian genes are in fact the most prolific and also the least intelligent, then genetic enslavement will be the destiny of their next generation." Shockley was specifically arguing against any social welfare programs on the grounds that they, quote, "may be encouraging dysgenics, retrogressive evolution through disproportionate reproduction of genetically inferior races." After the Nazi horror, which exposed the logical outcome of what this eugenics movement was, it was no longer tolerable to call it by its proper name. So George Bush took the lead in Congress to push what was euphemistically called family planning. It should also be noted, as Mike pointed out here, that Margaret Sanger, the creator of birth control, was a fanatical eugenicist. Now, I'd like the first transparency, please. In 1968, Pope Paul IV issued Humana Vitae, in which he said, quote, "Let it be considered also that a dangerous weapon would be placed in the hands of those public authorities who take no heed of moral exigencies. Who will stop rulers from favoring, from even imposing upon their people, the methods of contraception that they judge to be most efficacious? No solution of these difficulties is acceptable, which does violence to man's essential dignity. The only possible solution is one which envisages the social and economic progress both of individuals and whole human societies. Just days after Humana Vitae was issued, George Bush announced, "I have decided to give my vigorous support for population control in the United States and the world," adding, "For those of us who feel so strongly on this issue, the recent encyclical was most discouraging." What is not understood is that the genocide, which is far from being an egregious mistake, is being pursued as the policy of the United States, as documented by NSSM 200, by hardcore ideological racists who supported the Nazis because of their racial policies. Already under this policy, 25 million women in Brazil have been sterilized, many under coercion, others without even any knowledge it was being done. Next transparency, please. In a 1988 official government report, as part of a larger report on discriminant deterrence, in the concluding section entitled "Confronting the Challenge," the authors state, quote, "Some analysts argue that if 100 million people were infected, total deaths from AIDS in the 1990s could be 50 million. The number of infected then could double several more times after that and wipe out some countries in 10 to 20 years. If the number infected increased to 20% of the world's population, the delayed deaths could begin to cancel global population growth. In sheer terms of magnitude, it is rigorously provable that George Bush is 100 times worse than Adolf Hitler. And as you would suspect, the Anti-Defamation League of the B'nai B'rith support him. The reason nothing is being done about AIDS is because they want it. They could not be more explicit. The reason Bush invaded Panama and then Iraq was in fanatical pursuit of these ends. Yet the most egregious thing that George Bush did was demand that Lyndon LaRouche be placed in prison for life. As we have heard today, the only man on this planet who could solve these problems is now in a jail in Rochester, Minnesota. To free LaRouche and put him in the White House could be civilization's last chance. Bush has a very clear campaign strategy. It's modeled on the Roman Emperor Caligula's famous saying, "Let them hate me, but let them fear me." In our recent deliberations, it has become clear that Bush is conducting a reign of terror as his strategy. This was evident when he thought in the 1988 electoral campaign that Gary Hart was gaining in the polls. Very soon after, there was a scandal that wrecked Hart's campaign. Kennedy was mooted, was losing 30 pounds so that he could run and put his hat in the ring. And then he was hit with a major scandal. Jay Rockefeller mysteriously declared he was not ready and that he would not be running this year. Gephardt, who had angered Bush earlier this year, was all of a sudden leading the fight to support NAFTA and sold out his whole labor constituency. One wonders what happened to him. Jimmy Carter, who was thinking about a possible presidential ticket with Wilder, was shot at and found his name very soon after mentioned in the BCCI scandal. He has not pursued his intentions. Well, that's okay. Jesse Jackson has been told not to run. And Wilder, who was contemplating putting his name in nomination, was also hit with a scandal. Al Gore, to our surprise, recently announced, for family reasons, that he also would not run. The Iowa populist Tom Harkin seems to be the only serious threat, and he is that because he is a more fanatical Zionist than Bush. Why then is there no serious opposition by the Democratic Party? This becomes a most interesting question. In my recent visit to the West Coast, I had a series of meetings with trade union and activist layers in the Democratic Party. What emerged was a very fascinating picture. The UAW official I met with was thunderstruck by the position that the Democratic congressman took during the fight against the NAFTA legislation. He could not believe that Gephardt actually led the way for its passage. Then I met with what is known as the progressive wing of the Democratic Party, who were up in arms about how they were completely sold out during the fight against the U.S. entrance into the Persian Gulf. They were speechless when at the state convention, Tom Hayden was forced to lead the fight for the entrance into the war. This particular person actually attempted to beat up Hayden on the floor of the convention, but was restrained. It is well known that at least 40% of eligible voters now in Orange County are Hispanic. And inside the Orange County Democratic Party, only 10% of the party seats are held by Hispanics. They are completely disenfranchised by a voting bloc of Zionists and black machines that vote together to veto every single attempt at their representation. These Hispanic activists are very angry also about the unbelievable support that was received by the party for the NAFTA legislation. The old Roosevelt coalition of ethnic urban working class machines, along with minorities, to defend each other on social issues has completely broken down. In fact, as I shall prove, the Democratic Party at the top is the same apparatus as the Bush machine, and in fact are the enforcement arm of it. We have a case study of the Minnesota Democratic Party, which is paradigmatic of the essential problem. Leading into World War I and immediately after, there was a mass strike upsurge, which was led by what was known then as the Citizens Nonpartisan League. In the state of North Dakota, under the banner of Wild Bill Langer, this new formation was able to literally take over the state. These people resented the alliance that America had concluded with Britain during World War I and hated the monopolies and the Wall Street bankers. They had severe limitations on their positive approach, but they had all the right enemies. This grouping, called the Nonpartisan League, in 1918, ran in the Republican primary in Minnesota and came very close to winning. In their next attempt, they founded the Farmer Labor Party and became the second largest party in the state, which was behind the Republican Party and gathered more votes then than the Democratic Party. In Minneapolis, St. Paul, and Duluth, the most corrupt gangster machine in the country was being run by Jewish bootleggers, later dubbed the Cosa Nostra. Actually, by the London Times, not by an American paper. The Kingpin was a mobster by the name of Isidore Blumenfeld, also known as Kid Can. This machine was the illegal liquor mafia which ran Canadian Bronfman booze during Prohibition. With the proceeds of the illegal money, the mayor of Minneapolis and St. Paul, along with the police chief and the prosecutors of both cities, were totally owned by the mob, such that these two cities were known as the two most corrupt cities in the country. This network was run by none other than Meyer Lansky. This was later revealed during the Kefauver investigations, but the FBI never followed it up. As a series in New Federalists will document, this Zionist mafia machine took over the Farmer Labor Party and by the 1930s formed the Democratic Farmer Labor Party of Minnesota. This party created the Humphrey machine, who himself was the great protector of Kid Can. The way we discovered this was that Skip Humphrey, the present Minnesota Attorney General, went on a rampage against us in what seemed to be an already closed civil suit. What surprised us was how rabid he seemed to be. As many of you know, Humphrey was reversed by six judges and had to drop this foray. As we looked into this incident, what emerged was remarkable. The old Zionist drug and booze network funded completely Humphrey's 1988 electoral bid for the Senate. We are talking about the gambling interest in Las Vegas, the motion picture interest in Hollywood, along with top Zionist law firms in the country. This is the top levels of Dope Incorporated. This network was never touched by the FBI. So we have the spectacle that Skip Humphrey, who is totally funded by organized crime, will next year be the head of the State Prosecutor's Organization of the United States. Every single major Democratic Party candidate is bought and paid for in this way. The case of the Hollywood Mafia is even more extraordinary. In an upcoming series in New Federalist, we shall document that the entire popular entertainment industry is run by organized crime, predominantly Russian and Eastern European Jewish immigrants. Time Warner, Inc., $10.83 billion of capitalization, 35,000 employees. MCA, which owns Universal Pictures and Universal Studios, 17,000 employees. Paramount Communications and half a dozen other multimedia entertainment companies are owned completely by organized crime. The most powerful man in Hollywood mob today is a former Chicago lawyer and Lansky mouthpiece by the name of Sidney Korshak. Sidney Korshak was the major funder of the Brown Machine in California, organizing several fundraisers for Jerry Brown. But most importantly, Paul Ziffrin is Korshak's right-hand man and for years ran the DNC, the Democratic National Committee of California. It is not without some truth that Pat Buchanan during the Iraq War debate labeled Congress, quote, Israeli occupied territory. This Zionist mafia, which runs the Democratic Party, is literally the enforcement arm of $500 to $800 billion of dope money, which is now the sole prop of the Bush International Monetary System. As the series in New Federalist graphically details, every attempt that honest journalists in Minnesota made to expose this was met in each case by an assassination, and then no convictions of any assassins. The state legislature of Minneapolis was so corrupt, it passed the gag law that did not allow journalists to either accuse Floyd Olson, who was the prosecutor in Hennepin County, which is this Minneapolis area, during all of Prohibition. Every attack on this character was gagged, literally. They could not write an article to attack Floyd Olson without the paper being shut down. He was also ran later for governor of the state. It did not even allow an attack on Isidore Blumenfeld, who was Kid Can at that time. The police state apparatus was backed up by the court system. The country is run by one corrupt apparatus called Dope Incorporated. This is one nomenclatura which owns the party systems and the courts. If there are any illusions that the Democratic Party is the party of defense of working people or farmers and the poor, this would be a suicidal delusion. Our job is to rid the Democratic Party of Dope Incorporated. And toward that end, we will reissue that book. We are talking about a thoroughgoing revolution in this country to bring it back to law. It is no different than what the East Germans had to do in order to break the thug apparatus of the Honecker regime. this is more doable than one would normally think. Many ways to do it, actually. What we have witnessed over the last several days inside the Soviet Union and the republics have indicated that in no time before in post-war history has there been a more clear impulse toward freedom, simultaneously with a total discrediting of the free market Jeffrey Sachs type policies. Europe has on the agenda the scrapping of the whole Anglo-American policy toward Poland, Yugoslavia, and now most emphatically Russia. Bush and his whole apparatus have been completely paralyzed over the last 10 days to the extent that they have been unable to even recognize the Baltic republics. Never before has the issue of LaRouche been more clearly posed directly to the freedom movements around the world. The image we should have is that we so transform the political processes in this country that we have the kind of forces which will surround the Democratic Party convention, and we won't let them out till they nominate LaRouche. Yet how do we do this? Two underlying assumptions must be destroyed. One is that the free market is the basis for American prosperity. And the other is that while Bush is bad on domestic issues, he's really good on foreign policy. It seems that looking at it from the outside of the United States, the worse the atrocity that Bush commits, the more he seems to be popular. After Panama, his popularity went up. After the genocide in Iraq, it seemed to rise. His demand for the death penalty in the recent omnibus crime bill is hail. Unless we address effectively the underlying, literally Hobbesian view, in which Hobbes states that man is in a state of nature, is an animal who is in a war each against all, then we would find difficulty in changing the situation. We must address the underlying axiomatics. These axiomatics come from our culture. Would it surprise you to find out that the rock, drug, sex counterculture which produced this view of man is a product of Hollywood? All ideas that man is not imago viva Dei, but that the material world is only mechanical and does not change by subjective causality, turns man in his day-to-day activity into an animal. It would probably shock you to know that this dualistic view of man is the basis for communism, and that Hollywood was an explicit project to destroy the Christian view of man by avowed communists. First, most people don't understand the real evil Marxism represents. During the McCarthy period, the whole thing got deliberately garbaged up. Now, can we have the next transparency, please? It's two of them. In Marx's own words, in a little-known early piece called The Holy Family, he describes the essence of communism. Quote, "To speak precisely, and in a prosaic sense, French materialism has two directions, one of which has its origins with Descartes and the other with Locke. The latter is primarily a French formative element and proceeds directly into socialism. The former, mechanical materialism, proceeds into French natural science. Both directions crisscross each other in the course of their development. In his Physics, Descartes ascribed self-creating force to matter and conceived of mechanical motion as its living act. He completely separated his physics from his metaphysics. Within the compass of his physics, matter is the only substance, the only basis of being and knowing. French mechanical materialism took up Descartes' physics, but not his metaphysics. His students were professed anti-metaphysicians or physicists. By dissolving metaphysics with his skepticism, Pierre Bayle not only paved the way in France for the reception of materialist and the philosophy of common sense, he also announced the advent of atheistic society. Bayle was the last metaphysician in the spirit of the 17th century and the first philosopher in the spirit of the 18th century. While this is a whole lecture unto itself, it is important to highlight it in this context. In an extraordinary series of upcoming articles, Mike Minichino has proven beyond doubt that the Frankfurt School consciously set out to destroy Western civilization. George Lukacs, the man who set up the Frankfurt School, was one of the leading Comintern theoreticians who, from his first utterance when he joined the Communist Party, said, "Who will save us from Western civilization?" In Minichino's article, he states of Lukacs, quote, "Lukacs identified that any political movement capable of bringing Bolshevism to the West would have to be, in his words, demonic. It would have to possess the religious power which is capable of filling the entire soul, a power that characterizes primitive Christianity. However, Lukacs suggested such a messianic political movement would only succeed when the individual believed that his or her actions are determined by, quote, not a personal destiny, but a destiny of the community in a world that has been abandoned by God. Lukacs was clear that as long as the West believed in the divine nature of the individual soul, that Bolshevism would never take hold. Through a startling process, the Frankfurt School became the theoreticians of Hollywood and popular culture. It was they who created the political correctness movement that swept the universities. In the book, Dialectics of Enlightenment, two other members of the Frankfurt School, Max Horkheimer and Theodore Adorno, attacked the underlying basis for Christianity. They attacked the idea that freedom is the individual search for truth of God's creation. As Lynn has pointed out in Project A, it is the individual's direct, unmediated relationship with the universe as a whole and the ability to act on that knowledge efficiently on the past, present, and future in the present that defines man's primary existence. Freedom is defined by the individual's search for that universal truth regardless of prevailing public opinion. This is the opposite of the collective soul. Adorno and Horkheimer explicitly reject the possibility of such a truth based on natural law. They say that freedom is only achieved by the arbitrary use of will, since there is no such truth to have. In a bourgeois world, the highest form of art is the rejection of form and even tonality. Irrational destruction is equated with freedom. They criticized Hollywood for not being radical enough. It was not until Aldous Huxley, along with the CIA in the MK Ultra project, when they consciously drugged America, that Horkheimer and Adorno's dream was able to be realized in music, and now we see cannibalism and dismemberment on the silver screen. It would shock you how explicit the aims of Hollywood actually were. It is not possible to even talk about national security as long as Hollywood stands. Unless the U.S. returns to classical culture performed classically, there is no possibility to transform our civilization. Our job is to expose ruthlessly the kinds of chains of illusion that bind our fellow citizens. And if we do this effectively, then next year we shall see Lyndon LaRouche coming out of jail and being installed in the White House to lead us in a renaissance. Thank you.
we're going to go immediately to about 20 minutes more of Lynn's answers to questions from yesterday. So, Charles, can you go ahead and play that now? Following that, we'll have a question period.
Sorry for the interruption, but if we can shape events properly, as I indicated earlier in answer to another question, if we can set up a movement for a community of principle of the European states, reaching out to the states not only of Eastern Europe and the Balkans, but to the states of the former Soviet Union, and if we can establish a growing interest in cooperation along those lines, and also begin to take practical action to solve some of the problems, some of the leading problems, which various regions are now suffering, especially the unemployment problem, then we can shift the alternative so that Yeltsin is a transition to something good, as opposed to a transition to something bad. On the question of the second question from the annex, I believe, on the coming conference on the environment. Well, what is being proposed is absolute insanity and evil. There's only one way we can treat the environment, and that's by using high technology. Let's just take one point. Some few years ago, about 4 years ago, I produced a paper, produced a paper on the colonization of Mars. I did this as a continuation of some work I did in honor of a deceased friend, the Professor Kraft Erika, Dr. Kraft Erika, who had done grudge work on the industrialization of the moon with the view, as he emphasized repeatedly, that the moon next to our planet gave us the means to find a stepping stone to the planets beyond in space exploration. So I laid out what was technologically a perfectly feasible program, which within 40 years from a starting point, the United States, for example, could begin to have a task-oriented, quite useful, permanent colony on Mars, a colony the size of a fairly respectable city on Earth, on the lines of the original Los Alamos colony, somewhat larger, engaged in relevant space exploration functions such as astrophysical ones and space laboratory experiments, not on Mars, but in the vicinity of Mars, with Mars being an advanced base further away from the sun for astrophysical research by Earth in the search for anomalies in astrophysics, which would be useful for science on Earth. Now, we think about that project, and I did draw thinking about it. I thought about building cities on Mars, building farms and so forth on Mars. Now, can you imagine we're setting up a colony on Mars, everything is going along fine, and some idiot comes out from Earth sucking on LSD 25 sugar cubes and who knows what, and saying that we're ruining the Mars environment? What would we think of such a fellow? Or suppose that 50 years after that, once we've mastered the new energy source of matter, controlled matter, antimatter reactions, that we undertake the Earth forming of a moon of Saturn called Titan. Now, Titan happens to be about the same size as Earth and probably has about everything we need out there. And so we have to clean up the atmosphere, which is pretty poisonous right now, and things like that. But we could think about the Earth forming of Titan. Now, this is a very poisonous atmosphere. No human being, no form of life that we can think of would want to ever live there. Terrible place. Can you imagine the same thing? That, again, the proverbial environmentalist ecologist comes out with his ragged clothes, sucking on his LSD sugar cubes, and telling us that we're ruining the environment. Well, let's go back and look at Earth from that standpoint. What about this environment? What we wish to do is maintain the environment in the same way that an intelligent farmer in former times would maintain the improvement of farmland by putting in forests, woodlots, all the things that farmers did. That's our objective. Now, what these fellows are going down to do is essentially take a bunch of Indians who are probably going to die of the AIDS that they've contracted by sex with visiting anthropologists. I'm quite serious about that. That's what we've had an incidence of AIDS breakout of this, and the only thing people that come in there apparently are the anthropologists. So those, maybe sex with anthropologists is the way that AIDS is spread. I don't want to be unnecessarily cruel, but I think they deserve it. And what they're really doing is they're trying to get the minerals of Brazil, which lie accessibly in that area, and keep the Brazilians from using them. Why? Well, read Henry Kissinger's National Security Memorandum 200 from back in 1974 and the following years, matching statement from Brent Scowcroft, who succeeded Kissinger as Ford's National Security Advisor, the same thing. That's the reason. Now, if that happens, if that kind of thing is successful, along with Prince Philip and his son, Prince Charles, coming in and saying, we're going to throw God out and worship Gaia, who is the witch goddess of, the original witch goddess of the cult of Delphi, the site cult of Delphi in Greece. If that goes on, what happens to the human race? What happens if these things succeed? This is unacceptable. There is no acceptable arrangement under such. That must be defeated. That, and if it succeeds, it must be wrecked. Because the human race and environmentalism cannot live on the same planet. Okay, I have a question from, I guess again from the annex, from Willie Taylor from Indiana, I believe, with the connection between buggery and imperialism as well as science. Well, what's the issue here? Is as long as we recognize that man is different from any animal, and as demonstrated by the fact that we're capable of changing our way of living, increasing our potential population density by fundamental scientific progress, we recognize that man, unlike any animal, exists on the basis of creative powers, creative reason, the ability to generate, to transmit, and to assimilate for practice fundamental advances in respecting knowledge of the lawful organization of our universe. There's no animal species can do that, only man. Now, the fact that every human being has that potential, if they're properly educated, if they don't have the National Education Association running their school, means that we are showing and affirming the fact that every human being, individual human being, is a sacred person, a sacred human life. That they are equal by virtue of being human. Now, you can't have racism where everybody says, well, look, I don't care what your skin color is or what your hip bones look like. You have the same capacity which distinguishes, and all your children have the same capacity which sets all human beings apart from all animals. A capacity which defines all of us as being in the limited living image of the Creator. How can you have racism? How can you have a colonialism of the type that the British ran and others? How can you have a society which you say, well, old people, they're old. We got to kill them because the insurance, we can't afford to pay for the health insurance anymore, which is what's happening in the United States. It's called the Right to Die movement, the Living World movement. It's nothing more nor less than mass murder of the type that Hitler's Nazis did. That's all it is. There's your connection to imperialism. Once you accept the degradation of man, the perversion of man, is what the buggery represents. Make that the foundation of policy, as British empiricism has done. Then you have imperialism, because you no longer respect the sacredness of the life as in the image of the living Creator in the other person. You no longer respect the right of that child to have the kind of education which accords with developing within that child that which is in the living image of God. Once you throw that out, that spiritual value, that practical spiritual value, throw that out, disregard it, as the buggers demand, as the Cartesians demand, under the code of Deus Ex Machina, as the empiricists demand, under the code of Newton's principle of entropy, or Kelvin's principle of entropy, the same thing, or Clausius, the same thing. Then you no longer have a human society, a human species. What you have is one beast, a Hobbesian beast, eating another. And that's the connection.
Okay. I have a question for the science teacher. What we should do
question from a teacher on what we can do to improve science education and so forth in the schools. Well, the first thing I would insist upon, which is not unique, I would insist upon emphasis upon geometry, especially constructive geometry. I would introduce for example, in the secondary schools, but also for play in the primary schools, because you can plant a lot of good ideas in the elementary schools as well as the secondary schools with this stuff, with soap bubble work. Just water and glycerin, soap bubbles. We can do a lot of things with soap bubbles. We find children can do that. We find, as we found out at a summer camp some years ago where Dr. Moon took over and had little children in their 8, 9 years old, so forth, doing quite successfully and understanding Ampere's famous experiment, which is the foundation of the empirical understanding of electromagnetism. Things like that, the simple solenoid experiment. So if we introduce an enriched education, we can really do wonders. Of course, you have to get their attention. If they're high on coke or pot or something going on there, they're slouched out on pot, they're not going to pay much attention. But wherever we can, and wherever school districts can, the extent we can do that, and if those who are concerned will help one another to have the materials available which are needed to make the programs work where they're accepted, we can get something moving. At least wherever we try, we move a bit ahead. That's the foundation for moving further. I was simply, I think, add one thing, that the Jacobins, who were buggers, Robespierre's, Danton's, Marat's Jacobins, pretty much decapitated France and cut France off from a lot of its heritage of science. For example, the killing of Lavoisier by the Jacobins is an example of that. So in 1794-95, with the backing of Lazare Carnot, a former student of Monge's, Gaspard Monge founded the École Polytechnique. The problem of reproducing scientists was attacked by educating people in battalions, that they were called. This was Monge's method, and Monge produced a great number of battalions of some of the greatest scientific minds in 19th century Europe. We probably will find that we have to do that. Wherever we can, produce battalions, maybe platoons, at least a squad or two of younger people who have the means to understand science on a secondary level. And a rigorous grounding in geometry, geometry including analysis cetus, or in that sense, is the foundation which they need to go on to something good. I have to say a lot more on this, but I think that's probably enough for the time being. Okay, the question on what Africans can do in this time to help the rest of the world. What we have to do is to get out of this regionalism. We have to have Africans, without being disengaged from the problems of Africa, be engaged at the same time in what the rest of us are doing. For example, the participation in, at least in the intellectual side, some of the political side, in Europe, in what I refer to as establishing a community of principle to address the foremost problems confronting us there now. In the United States, we need to bring people from various parts of the world together around the kinds of problems we're discussing, to discuss global policy. I'll give a negative example of that. One of the things that ruined Africa was particularly the Africa, sub-Saharan Africa. What they did in Arab, Islamic Africa is one thing, but sub-Saharan, largely black Africa, was another story. We had two things coming out which were against Africa. The British were selling black nationalism, and under which they sold everything they wanted to. And the French were settling negritude. The problem was that the Africans, who were sponsored by the French or by the British or by the Americans under British rule, were generally those who had been selected on the basis of being conditioned on these kinds of programs. Well, and they were told this was good for Africans. Well, it's bunk. Now, Africa has special problems. But a baby born in black Africa is no different than a baby born in any other part of the world, except in the conditions under which they're born. The problems of life, the problems helping the process by participating, and is also improving the chances of accomplishing something in Africa in many ways. I could say much more on this, but again, time is a problem, and maybe somebody else will come up over the coming days and I can respond to it. On India, Pakistan, and Bangladesh, what is obviously needed is something very similar to what I've suggested is needed for Europe. What is needed immediately is not a blueprint for solution, though certain blueprints are needed for infrastructural development of the region. What is needed is a mechanism, a political social process of the type that I had once hoped before he was murdered that Rajiv Gandhi would do, as he tried to do with Pakistan earlier, in trying to avoid war between Pakistan and India over any of a number of issues. There must be peaceful solutions based on the recognition of the common problem and a common interest in the solution to a common problem, as opposed to anything else. From that, the idea of the establishment of a community of principle leads to whatever should be led to. I don't think that we can put blueprint solutions on top of nations' political institutions. What we can do is we can create the environment in which acceptable political solutions will grow up out of a favorable environment. And that's the way I would approach it. Okay, on the question on the 1992 Columbus Project. Well, the first thing is the truth has to come out about it. What is put out by Fidel Castro and others about Columbus and his impact and the impact of Europe on the Americans is actually a lot of lies. Some very terrible things were done to the state of America by the British East Indies, by the British Hudson Bay Company and things of that sort, fur trappers and all these games. Now, what was done to the Cherokees, for example, by that great fascist, President Andrew Jackson, before he was president, is also an example of atrocities. But if you take the condition of Mexico, for example, under these brutal Aztecs, cutting out tens of thousands of hearts for a ceremony of their victims and captive, they were running a fascist dictatorship of the worst sort. And the reason that Cortez was, or the Spanish in general, were successful with a few men in overthrowing it is because they came to power over the Aztecs as a result of a very popular movement among the most of the indigenous population of Mexico. Now, the Christianization of the Americas was a good thing. What was done by the usurers, such as the Venetian bankers, the ones who were collecting tribute, looting the country, on the basis of the same thing that's called North American Free Trade Alliance today, that was bad. So the North American Free Trade Alliance idea back in the days of the Fuggers was bad. It's also bad today. It's evil. That should be removed without question. But let's look at Columbus. The idea of the project of colonization was the result of a project which goes back, if one knows the literature, to Plato. The colonization of Magna Graecia by the Greeks was a very significant idea in the mind of Plato, and he wrote about colonization projects, not as colonizing upon people, but colonizing, the development of taking the lessons of one civilization, taking it off to another place, and using those lessons so as not to repeat the mistakes which were still encumbering the area from which one had come. The idea of the colonization of the Americas, or discovering routes to the East, was essentially an idea of tipping the balance in world civilization in such a fashion that the problems in Europe could be solved. The benefits in terms of population, population growth, population size, in terms of longevity, in terms of conquest of disease, and so forth in general, wherever the Christian element of colonization predominated, as opposed to the looting usurers, this was the benefit. The benefit to the Americas and the benefit to humanity from Columbus discovery is tremendous. Fidel Castro notwithstanding. But at the same time, when Europe came to the Americas, it was more than Christianity came. There also came, we had Aztecs in Europe too, who would cut your heart out for interest payment on usury. And they did. So there is a mixed history, the history of the good, which is brought by Christianity, the respect for the sacredness of the individual human life. And there's the bad, which is brought by the usury, in the form of those who in the 16th century, as today, believed in a North American Free Trade Association approach, which is otherwise known in Germany during the last war as the Auschwitz approach. I got a question I understand from Bob Arnold in Baltimore on N plus one dimensionalities. The problem is when we talk about N1 dimensionalities, we're not talking about simple geometries in the ordinary sense, but we're actually talking about what Cantor refers to as his LF number series of cardinalities. So is there an upper limit? Well, that's a funny question in this sense. Obviously, there is a complementarity between largeness and smallness. That we run into in physics all the time, regularly, you know, speed and light and other things and so forth, how they inverse relationship in orders of magnitude. But it's probably something that does operate like that. But actually, you know, the universe is developing. It is not completed development. The universe is not perfected. It is the becoming. God is perfected, but the universe is not. It's still becoming. So how far it's become, I wouldn't essay to know. What I do know is what is happening and has been happening now. And I would reduce what I attempted to represent back there in 1978 in these secrets known only to the inner elites was the idea of an equivalence, of a type. And I know the type as to what the bounds are, what the upper bounds are, the lower bounds are. I'm not quite sure what they are. Obviously, at any given point in time in the process of becoming, there probably are limits. But that's about as much as I would attempt to say on that in that way. I simply say that the N to N plus one, that is a type, as Carter would describe it, and that's the type I know, and my purpose in that particular writing was to introduce that type simply for the same reason I did that in Defense of Common Sense and other writings, in trying to present to people in an intelligible form how can you demonstrate in an intelligible, constructible way what we mean by creative reason. And that's the purpose of the thing, is to demonstrate the principle of creative reason and the fact that this creative reason is in conformity with the way we increase man's per capita power over the universe. In answer to Kathy Notley's question on do I see in the collapse of Bolshevism, which has occurred in the past weeks, in the former Soviet Union, something comparable the way of proposal to my Operational Juarez proposal of 1982 or the Triangle proposal of the end of 1989? Well, yes, I have just identified it today in response to twice to earlier questions. The development of a network of collaboration around the idea of a community of principle involving the states of Eastern Europe, other peripheral states around the European community market, and centered around the productive triangle as a focal or leverage point or keystone. The involvement of people in Europe, that is in the European community, in this, to build up a rising tide of political demand for this kind of solution. That's what must be done. That's what must be done to try to shift the process inside the former Soviet Union, including inside Russia, in the direction necessary to have caused the transition to shift in the direction which is least the desired result. Okay, five-fourths, or the answer to the question on Bacon. How do we know what Bacon was? How do we know that he's the scoundrel that I view him to be? Well, there's various ways you know that. First of all, you know who people attack, and Bacon attacked people such as Kepler. But Bacon's particular bête noire was Gilbert. Gilbert was the fellow who in 1600 published the paper called De Magneta, which had a great influence on Kepler, by the way. Gilbert was the discoverer of, probably, unless we find some Leonardo da Vinci papers in place, it shows precedence for Leonardo, but Gilbert was the discoverer of plasma physics. He was the one that discovered a plasma, electromagnetic plasma, inside the flame of a candle. He's a great man, great scientist, in the same tradition generally, not as great as Kepler in terms of magnitude, but a very truly great scientist. And Bacon said, this is what we have to get rid of. So you look at Bacon's own actions and writings, in which he defends or explains behavior which he actually took. Then you look at the Baconian Circle around King James I and what they did and what they were. And there's no doubt. I'll give another example of this kind of thing. Let's take the case later, so over a century later. You have Jeremy Bentham in the 18th century. Now, Jeremy Bentham wrote on the principles of morals and legislation. This guy, you could hang him as a hardened, incurable felon on the basis of that book. Then he wrote things like In Defense of Pederasty and In Defense of Usury, and a great number of other things the same way. Or Adam Smith. Adam Smith's own writings particularly prove this fellow was one of the most immoral scoundrels ever imagined. I mean, the fellow belongs in jail as a on a conspiracy charge for drug pushing. The guy is a criminal. A master criminal of the Adolf Hitler dimensions. There's no question about his own writings and actions. Or the second Earl of Shelburne. Or the first Duke of Marlborough. And so forth and so on. And that in some cases, granted, you have two problems. One problem, you don't have enough information to come to a definite conclusion. Obscure people generally. But people who are right, people who are articulate, who state their own ideas, as Aristotle did, for example, manage to get their writings published in a form which is, and when you have a whole writing, not selected distortions taken out of context, you've got one thing. You also have a second problem, is that there are secondary sources in particular, which will tend to be distorting. Well, most of the distorting secondary sources are those which praise Bacon. Take the case of Bacon's closest associate, a very intimate associate, one is informed, Thomas Hobbes. This man is a monster. The old word, old hob, came from that. Then you take John Locke, an absolute beast. Or look at the chest of Bacon's papers, or Newton's papers, rather. Look at them. Horrible stuff. So then you look at what Bacon did to John Bull, the musician. Drove him out of England, burned all his works, so on, et cetera, and bragged about it. So in the case of Bacon, we have an abundance of documented sources of Bacon's own authorship and evidence of his own actions, which he takes credit for his own authorship, which leaves no doubt that this man is a self-professed scoundrel, and events confirm that he is the criminal that he pretends to be. So, granted, yes, and then Franklin, but you wouldn't have a problem in Franklin if you go back to use the same standard for Franklin we use for Bacon. Go back to his own sources, his own actions, his own writings, and the writings of the people with whom he's associated, the actions of these, and you can prove the case fairly well. It's not quite as difficult as some people would pretend to determine these things. It's we're so accustomed to frauds in our universities and our textbooks and in the pages of the New York Times and Washington Post that we assume that fraud is easily done. No, you have to cover up an awful lot. You get a lot of very lazy people who will accept the gossip they hear from their friends in order to get a good fraud across. Otherwise, there are diligent people around who will dig into the papers and who have enough sense and enough self-respect not to spread rumors about people unless they're true.
We're going to take about a half hour questions. Helga is on the line. She will be on the line soon, so you can line up for questions. I have one written question, which I'll, or two actually, but I'll begin with one of them. This is from Bill's Edition from New Jersey to Jonathan Tennenbaum. He says that Dr. Moon has brought mankind from macro Keplerian motion to 10 to the minus 10 meter motion. Mankind is able to scale down fission reactors to modified high temperature gas reactors for geographic and economic feasibility. And we have gone from steamships, the SS Savannah, I believe, to nuclear propulsion, to submarine nuclear propulsion. And within the context of the triangle, he asks, the transportation systems, is there a massive effort? Is nuclear locomotion under research?
Well, we study the way living organisms really work, then maybe when we walk, there's something going on there. I would emphasize the following thing. I've been doing, and others have been doing, studies of the history of science, going back in different directions. But I took the history of nuclear energy, in particular nuclear fission, and started to look at that very carefully from different standpoints, one just a polemical standpoint, a devious polemical standpoint, but also I wanted to learn as much as possible about how science is maintained and developed as a continuous process. And I think that's the most essential thing linking to the triangle and the deeper effect of the triangle, that you had in Europe over periods, over decades and decades, over centuries, but I would start particularly from the time of Leibniz on. You have a scientific development which I can only compare really to a Bach fugue. If you listen to one of the great Richard Carres of the musical offering, and you listen carefully and you see how the fugue is developing and new degrees of freedom are continuously introduced, in a certain sense the fugue could be carried forward indefinitely. It's ended and then you have other fugues, but the idea is it rolls forward and develops out of itself, becomes more richer, more profound, and so forth. And that was, to the best of my ability right now, to give a notion of what the scientific development, European-centered scientific development was. It keeps rolling forward. It's not an assembly of great discoveries and great ideas that pop up like flashing lights, but it's a way of educating people, it's a way of life, of the scientists, but also of the society around them. And our problem, part of our problem, is that this process is essentially stopped or brought to a halt in our period. And so we have only a very limited living memory of that. If you want to, I would just point you one direction on the nuclear thing. What is fascinating is to look at the way in which the work of Mendeleev on the periodic table, coming essentially out of the work of Kepler, as the same conception. It's not that we first had the Kepler work on the macro, and then we discover that there's a microscopic thing. But if you look at Kepler, he already has this idea. When, for example, he says that the different harmonic orbits, the planets in the different harmonic orbits, have different composition, have a different microscopic composition. This is not, so it's not as if you have suddenly something popping up, but rather you have a kernel, like a seed of a plant, which is continuing and developing as you go on. The problem is once you lose that seed, once you lose that process, then it falls apart into a lot of little predicates and stops. So if we look at the periodic table as one very important aspect of how this nuclear, because the nuclear physics and nuclear energy, I can demonstrate, develops organically out of the Kepler conception through the periodic table. And in the case of Mendeleev, it was linked very directly with an idea of Listian economic development in Europe, as I believe Barbara Fraser wrote a very beautiful article documenting this, the Vita Mendeleev, Paris, Heidelberg combination. So that if you look the people looking at it, people like Nodak and so forth, as I've pointed out, and the more I look at it, the more rich it becomes. We're looking at the periodic table and saying, this is telling us about the ordering of the microscopic realm, not the table in the formal sense. This idea that you have a universal function of matter. It's not the same thing as the British idea of the universal particle or the universal elementary particle. It's not the same thing. The universal function of matter. It's not saying all matter is built up out of a lot of little things. There's a universal function. It's a Cantorian transfinite kind of function. And that you're looking at the harmonic organization of that function. And that leads you directly to nuclear energy. So that's what I would say. In terms of the future development, I think when we look at something like the cold fusion, whatever that is, and if we re-educate ourselves, I speak of that from the standpoint of the scientists today, as Lynn's been trying to re-educate the science today. If we re-educate ourselves in understanding what science is as a process, then we're going to find all kinds of things in the same way as it just rolls forward. So different propulsion, all these sorts of things, they fall out of this kind of a process. If we're doing science, if we're searching for the truth from the standpoint of a method, then we encounter all of these things. And it comes just as a very natural, organic process.
Fred, are you asking a question for Helga?
Well, I didn't know if she was on the line. I was going to ask Gerry Rose a question.
Okay, she won't be on the line for a few minutes, so go
Gerry,
ahead.
A lot of information indicates that at Baden-Baden, they crowned Clinton as the star rising in the Democratic Party with Wilder as vice president. Everything we're picking up on TV and other sources I've run into indicates the same thing. What is your perception on that? That's Clinton of Arkansas that they're trying
right.
to do.
Well, there's a very interesting process afoot. We've gotten several indications, both reported on in the New York Times, in which the former head of Carter's campaign, a guy by the name of White, is talking about an open convention. What the actual thinking is right now is that, and several people have hailed this, is that since they cannot come up with a candidate, and since everybody who has attempted has got a dirty trick against them, the idea would be to elect, well, what they call for was the governors of each state to run as favorite sons, that these favorite sons would have a whole slate behind them, and then come in uncommitted to the convention, have a debate, and then choose a candidate out of the debate. Now, this cuts both ways. On the one hand, Mel was pointing out, and he's very correct in this, this is the Moynihan proposal, because what you have are what's called superdelegates. These superdelegates are people who are already elected to Congress, already elected to public office, and they automatically go as delegates, and that rather than the expensive process of putting on this idiocy before the population, they'll do it in the back, smoke-filled back rooms. That's one possibility. The other possibility is what we intend to do. I mean, there's going to be a revolt in this country. I have no illusions about it. They're not going to be able to keep the lid. It is like a manhole cover on Krakatoa. I mean, they're not going to be able to keep the lid on. It's going to blow. Okay, under conditions where we come into the convention and really elect delegates to that convention, one of two things will happen, which happened in 1968 in Chicago. I wasn't there, okay? But what happened, I heard about it. it was a wild scene, apparently. They actually did surround the convention. And what happened inside the convention reflected the process that was going on outside the convention. That many delegations that they refused to seat got seated out of just the whole revolutionary process that occurred in the country, which was reflected inside. Because the Democratic Party has sold out completely the farmer, the person who works, anyone who has any interest in dignity, they've sold out everybody in a very specific, in the way that I identified here. So therefore, what we're looking at is a total revolutionary transformation that begins to reflect itself inside the convention. In other words, the question came up, should we run in each primary? Absolutely not. We run for the national, we run for a national effect, right? That Lynn has to get on TV, which means we're going to need matching funds in 20 states. I mean, there's certain minimum requirements. We're going to get all the minimum requirements that Lynn goes on nationwide TV several times in the process of this so-called primary. We go for the national effect. On the basis of the national effect, where we expose the Zionist control of the Democratic Party. We've got to be vicious about this thing. Let's not kid ourselves. There's no Democratic Party. That's a joke. That's a joke, right? We rid them of these bozo mafia idiots, right? Then on the process of organizing the constituencies back into the Democratic Party, either they dissolve the Democratic Party, in which case we become something else, or call ourselves, well, we call ourselves the Freedom Democrats or whatever we want to call ourselves. And freedom has a very good name nowadays. basically, we take over the Democratic Party. But that's the process. Not primary by primary. It's silly. But by national effect. And publishing doping and publishing the kinds of exposés and getting a massive readership of our newspaper that will read these exposés, get it to their friends, and say, we're taking over, we've had it, the freedom movement is here in the United States.
In terms of the Bush sellout of the labor movement, the Baltimore Sun this morning, in the coverage of the several hundred thousand labor people who marched in Washington yesterday, on the front page reports also, quote, there were advocates of other unrelated causes too. One group of demonstrators held a sign reading, "Impeach Bush, Free LaRouche." Helga is on the line now, so you can address a question to Helga. Yes.
Oh, I have this one for Gerry, if that's okay.
Helga might wish to respond as well. Go ahead.
Okay, great. As you say, the Democratic Party, except for LaRouche's people, doesn't really exist. What's the point in getting the Gephardts and the Rockefellers and their ilk to drop out of the race since they're not offering anything? Is it just to keep the muscles in shape for the tough guys?
Well, George Bush is famous. He's a sore sport. There's famous stories, which will come out in this book we're writing about him. He's psychotic, okay? And his problem is, and it always has been, I'll tell you a story just to give you a little background on this character, and it's also his weakness, too. What happened was in the initial elections he ran in, he ran against a good Democrat, actually a very good Democrat, a guy by the name of Yarborough, who was pro-labor, pro-development, very interesting man, who set up the National Science Foundation and Education Acts. Anyway, Yarborough beat him in his initial attempt. But in the course of this attempt, where he ran for Senate against Yarborough, he had sued for redistricting. And given that his daddy was Prescott Bush, one of the Harrimans' top people, they made a designer district for him where they cut out, no, this is literally true. They took the few districts that he won against Yarborough and they created a silk stocking designer district. And that essentially he got elected in that silk stocking for Congress in that silk stocking district. He's a stupid man. He only keeps in power because of the ability to knock his opponents out. He's a very arrogant, stupid man. and a very evil man. Now, we're going into a non-linear period in which anything could happen. Absolutely anything could happen. I mean, he thought he had a condominium. Look at it from a global strategic standpoint. His whole policy was based upon, I've got to deal with Gorbachev on the freedom movements. I've got to deal with Gorbachev on Cuba, where he was going to invade Cuba. I've got to deal with Gorbachev on this. I've got to deal with Gorbachev on that. Okay, now they're facing a situation where all deals are off. There is no Gorbachev. It's a completely non-linear, wild situation. Warren, later on, either today or maybe, you know, later on tomorrow, will go through an incredibly non-linear situation in the UN itself, among nations, right? Okay, under those conditions, Bush does not want any opposition, right? Any opposition could under, and we've seen this spread. Imagine, think of it from another standpoint. When Lynn stood at the Berlin Wall and said that Germany will be reunited and that it should vector itself on Poland, who thought that a year later the wall would come down? Nobody. Who thought that Bolshevism would be dead even 2 weeks ago? No one. So we are dealing with completely nonlinear processes. So Bush himself, the reason he's knocking these people off is not so much that he himself is worried about them, although he's a very stupid man and a bad campaigner. He is more concerned, I mean, it's sort of like it's instinctual with him. He doesn't like any criticism, okay? I mean, he's very angry at us, for instance. In fact, Helga had this very good little idea, which I think we should do if someone's a good designer here. We wanted to get a little punching bag with Bush's face on it, okay? And the name of it would be Beat Bush, okay? And then you hit it in the head, but it doesn't come up. You know how these punching bags, you know? So that kind of thing. So he's very angry. He's a very unstable character. He also has a very bad health problem, and we're dealing with a very nonlinear period. So he's just knocking these guys off out of venality, but also out of a certain amount of fear. This is his weakness.
Helga, do you want to comment?
No, Pete Bush.
That already was her comment. Yes. Oh, okay. All right.
My question was for Nancy, but since Helga's on the line, perhaps she'll have something to say as well. My question was, I'll just say, I'm aware that the present level of moral degeneracy in this country presents a huge challenge to execute what I'm about to propose. However, I'd like to know what you think about reviving a regular publication of a theoretical journal similar to the Campaigner. Organizing with the Campaigner demanded Americans to think, and it made clear that our movement, the LaRouche movement, expected even the lowliest laborer to master necessarily difficult and profound conceptions. And I personally remember, and I'll never forget, experiences of organizing truck drivers to buy the Contour Campaigner, and later, you know, calling these people back and finding handfuls of them grappling with the antinomies. What do you think?
I think that's absolutely what we should do. I already discussed this with several people, and I think we should really absolutely do it.
I would just like to add, and it is notable when you go back and read the old pamphlets, because, for example, that Rockefeller's Fascism with a Democratic Face is all addressed to working people to actually master the concept of what will happen, how the universe will devolve if a negentropic economic and scientific process is not carried out, as absolutely essential. I would just add the whole question of books and note that we have coming up very soon a book of LaRouche's prison writings, A Science of Christian Economy, Project A and Common Sense, and that one of the major things that I think will be a rallying point and the kind of challenge that you're talking about will be creating a real mass market for that book. And I would encourage everyone to think in that direction in the immediate period as well.
Let me take that opportunity to answer another question that was sent in from Bill's edition to myself, which asks me to comment on the receptivity of the fellow convicted prisoners while I was in jail to organizing efforts. And let me just say briefly that, first of all, as you all know, probably the only expanding industry in America is the prison industry. It's becoming a mass scab labor force, which we'll be writing a great deal on in the coming period, in terms of the maquiladoras in Mexico being used to destroy what exists of industry in exchange for outright slave labor. What you have is a rapidly expanding number of people being shoved into the prison system. Most of them have already been through a process of 8, 10, 15, 20 years of mental menticide. Both through drugs, through the culture they live in, through the lack of a culture in the United States. The lack of education, the literal illiteracy of the, and I think the prison population, and I believe this to be true, is a general cross-section of the forgotten population, the lower 50% perhaps of the American population. It's a cross-section. It's not just the lowest bottom or something. And the level of illiteracy and moral depravity that's been shoved onto these people is appalling. With that said, however, and therefore not to glorify the prison population by any means, with that said, the openness and the longing for something which brings coherence to an otherwise totally incomprehensible, terrifying world in which the vast majority of the American working people, as well as so-called underclass, live, is enormous. And in terms of that question and our addressing this broad layer of the population that's been left to rot in the cultural wasteland of Hollywood and so forth, it's open, it's going to be very, very difficult, but it's absolutely essential and it's there to be done. And we are uniquely positioned and certainly the only people in the world capable of it, and we must succeed.
Okay, this is directed to Helga. It deals with the strategic issue. Can we safely say that the SDI is directly responsible for the events going on in the Soviet Union right now? In other words, the coup and the breakup after the coup of the Soviet Union, it seems to me that it can only have happened given that perestroika and glasnost has been in place for several years, and glasnost and perestroika is a result of the SDI being implemented as a policy anyway in 1983. So I was wondering if you could give me some of your thoughts on that or expand on that, or if I'm going too far, if we can say actually that the SDI is responsible for the breakup of the Soviet Union and the whole East Bloc.
Well, I think one can say that the SDI, not the SDI, but rather the failure of the Soviet leadership at the time to take the chance which Lin had offered is what really is one of the, I would say, two major reasons. I would say that one of the reasons which I think had also a very important role is the role of this Pope. Given the fact that this Pope is Polish and, unlike previous popes, knew the communist system and its horrors from the inside, so he had no illusions of what he was dealing with, and at the other side made a lot of speeches addressing the youth of Poland and the people in the East, giving them hope and telling them never to give up hope. I think this was psychologically extremely important if you understand, you know, how this dictatorship looked from the inside behind the Iron Curtain. But I would say the other major influence is the SDI. And we have been told this by several people from the Baltics, but also from Ukraine, that they remember very well when Lin had proposed the SDI or what became the SDI, that they had read these vitriolic attacks against Lyndon LaRouche in Izvestia, Red Star, and various other Soviet publications, and that then they understood that this had to be an extremely important item, because if somebody gets so violently attacked, that it had to be something major, and the attacks were quite something. I mean, we were called troglodytes, we were called, they called the marriage between Lynn and myself the marriage between Rambo and Teutonia, with the appropriate pictures. So, but, you know, I think it was the failure of the Soviets to recognize the chance which was in this proposal, because, I mean, what did Lynn say? He said, you know, one of the most beautiful documents Lynn has ever written was this draft proposal for a protocol between the superpowers, which was the idea that, you know, both of them should get rid of the neo-Malthusians in their own ranks, both in science, politics, economics, and that there should be a crash program of these new technologies based on new physical principles around the SDI technologies, and that that should become, like previously, the Apollo program, the NASA program, a science driver for the civilian economy. And that way, basically, the backward economic system of the Soviet Union would be transformed and brought up to a modern level, and that the science driver application in, you know, the North would then become the motor for a huge technology transfer to the developing countries. And basically that both superpowers should stop to treat the third world as playgrounds for proxy wars among them, and that basically they should guarantee national independence, national sovereignty for all nations in this world, and really use this chance not to have disarmament in the usual kind of way, but, you know, to basically make nuclear weapons obsolete by simply producing a technology which would make the defense less expensive than the offense, and by that way have, for the first time, a way of really establishing peace. Now, obviously, the fact that the Reagan administration, at least very temporarily, picked up this proposal meant that there was momentum in this direction. We know what happened, that basically this policy was immediately perverted on the side of the United States and went back to all kinds of point defense and other kinds of reduced off-the-shelf technologies and so forth. But from the side of the Soviets, they completely rejected it. And we know that this was one of the, you know, both Malthusian factions in both superpowers went absolutely in the other direction. Because, you know, on both sides, it would have meant to give up the liberal kinds of economic policies which, you know, are responsible for the two systems which now collapse. Now, we know that the Soviets, instead of, you know, going with this proposal, went into an enormous military build-up which stretched their economic systems up to the point that indeed, you know, I mean, it just went completely overboard. So, you know, it's again, sometimes greed and pursuing of false interests leads to your destruction. If the American banks would have taken up Lynn's proposal in 1982 to reorganize the international banking system, Lynn at that point said, you know, we will reorganize the banks and they will survive, if even with a reduced power, but they will survive. Now this is no longer the case. The Soviet Union would have probably survived even if, you know, reduced power and so forth, but they rejected this transformation, and now they have to pay the price. But Lynn has emphasized many, many times that the productive triangle is really based on exactly the same economic principle, namely to have this kind of science driver to get, you know, to get the kind of locomotive effect which brings this world out of this depression. So, you know, answering your question, I would say, yes, I would say the conceptions, not so much the SDI as it was proposed by the U.S. administration, which immediately was watered down and, you know, changed in its conception, but especially the proposal which Lynn put on the table. And, you know, Lynn was in discussion with the Soviets at that time, with the full knowledge of the United States government. And, you know, I know that the Soviets, knowing Lin's intellect and knowing the other people they were dealing with, they immediately understood Lin to be the author behind this conception. So I would say yes, one can actually say, can answer your question, the Lin's proposals were a very influential point in bringing the present configuration about.
You want me to go?
Yes.
Helga, this is Lester Dahlberg. I want to ask you a question. How can we put Adam Smith's free trade market in the trash can? Well, we need to be more effective to get this out to the general public, I believe. If we could get them rallied up and mad enough, I think we can kick George Bush out of the White House and put Lynn in there. Let's get after it.
Well, I think I can only reiterate what I already said yesterday. I mean, look, on the one side, I think we are reaching a critical point where people, you know, who have been victimized by the grip of the IMF, the World Bank, for many years, now there is a point reached where people start to see that this cannot continue or the world will go up in flames. And I can only say that the Yugoslavian example is really what people must understand. The IMF, the free market policy, leads to war everywhere on this planet where it will be applied, either civil war or other kinds of horrors. On the other side, you know, because of the total violation of the self-interest of the nations of Eastern Europe, which the Polish model has underlined, a lot of people really started to have second thoughts. And right now we have in a lot of republics in the former Soviet Union and the reform states of Eastern Europe, anti-IMF factions developing, who already in the past invited members of the Schiller Institute to conferences where we would represent our view. And they would represent, they also invited people from Harvard to represent the Adam Smith view, to have a public debate about it. And I think right now we are in a situation where, because of the crisis, because of the hope of the revolution bringing down Bolshevism, it's a tremendous historical moment of chance right now. I think if we put these different elements together and build the coalition to realize the TRIAC proposal, I think we can really make it. And I again would like to invite the people who participate in this conference and who have understood that this is maybe the last chance for civilization to come out of this crisis without going through an even more horrible, nightmarish development. They should really join this coalition, because, you know, I think if we create an international movement to use the opening created by the bringing down of the borders of Eastern Europe, bringing down of Bolshevism, to use this incredible historical chance to build a movement for a community of principles among sovereign nations on this planet, so that we put foreign policy and all kinds of international policy on the basis of natural law. If people understand that, they should join this movement and help us to catalyze it, which I think is the best way of really, you know, putting Adam Smith in the trash can. Karl Marx in the trash can, Adam Smith in the trash can, Bush out of the White House, and, you know, Lin in there. I think we should go with it.
I apologize, but we'll just take one more question because of the time. Go ahead.
Helga. This is Bob Fowle from Philadelphia. I wrote a poetic tribute to Lyndon LaRouche, which was published, but you may not have read it. I'd like to recite it to you. It's called HaTikva, Hebrew for Hope. My Jewish view of Jesus Christ is this: God's instrument of himself he did make. The policy that he would not forsake was labor to give birth to human bliss.
the oligarchy of satanic few requiring deadheads in the governed mass watched fearfully the stirring in that class, touched by the prayer of that Platonic Jew. Ben Franklin trod the same path we move on, to promised land of sweet bel canto song. LaRouche in jail, the head of movement strong, leads yet till universe for man is one. The Jew, no matter where in time he be, must side with Lynn to set all mankind free. Thanks.
Oh, that's very beautiful.
We'll make this the last question.
I'm Taysir Nashi from the United Nations. My question is to Mrs. LaRouche and to Dr. Tennenbaum. Is there a global economic interdependence? If so, I would like that you demonstrate the existence of the economic dependence of the industrial states on the developing world.
Did you get that, Helga?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, I mean, obviously, this independence, interdependence exists, but I think, well, I mean, I think that what we have to remedy is the injustices in the economic system. We have been campaigning on this since a long time, that the entire international monetary system, from its beginning, the Bretton Woods system, has been completely unjust to the developing countries by putting their parities in such that proportion that they have been disadvantaged from the very beginning. They had to sell cheap and buy import expensive, and you know, as the years continued, this dependency and disadvantage became worse and worse and worse. And one can actually say that since the middle of the 70s, when the IMF conditionalities really started to go into full gear, basically colonialism has been reintroduced completely. And that is a matter of fact. There has been what we call primitive accumulation, basically from the side of the IMF forces, which primarily is really the U.S. government and its military force backing the IMF, which has been engaged in this looting of third world economies. And I think that has to be changed, and we have to fight and reestablish economic justice, not only for individuals, but also for nations. Now, that doesn't mean that everybody will be, basically in the same, in exactly the same level. But what we have proposed, and what Lynn has proposed in particular, is that we have to have an approach for the developing countries where they basically are part of an international division of labor, where there is absolutely no need for developing countries that they should have so-called appropriate technologies forever, which is just the rationalization of keeping them in dependency and backwardness. There is no need that so-called third world countries should take used up technologies, so-called appropriate technologies, from the so-called advanced countries, like older siblings giving their clothes to the smaller siblings, and the smaller siblings have to wear these old clothes forever, which frustrates them a lot. But that we have to have a division of labor, where each country picks an area where they must become the best of the world, where they must become the avant-garde of the world. And, you know, there are sometimes it's very obvious what that could be, that, you know, for example, we discussed this in the case of Mexico, that because of certain geographical conditions, they are in an absolutely magnificent condition to be experts in astrophysics. And so they should pick areas where they, you know, start to become the leading scientific and force in the world. And I think if one really breaks out of this limited world, of this, you know, this closed system, which, you know, the Aristotelian view tries to impose, the illusion that we are in a system of fixed raw materials, of fixed resources, and that, you know, we somehow have to fight for these resources, and therefore, you know, then you get into this horrible Malthusian Darwinian logic. But if you really look at the universe as it is, if you understand that the universe is neckentropic, and that it is the human creativity which opens up new degrees of freedom, then you can easily see that, you know, once we bring forward the creativity of all people on this planet, that there are tremendous realms to open in the fields of science, of culture, of music. And, you know, basically, we can, you know, basically really start to make a new golden renaissance for this mankind. I mean, look, if people in the 15th century could overcome the horrible dark age of the 14th century, which was very similar to our time in terms of plague, death, epidemics, superstition, starvation, and they could make the beautiful Italian golden renaissance out of this, which has contributed for 500 years to come to our civilization, why should not we, who are, you know, today again presented with the same challenge, but also with the same chances, say, yes, we can make a golden renaissance, and we will. And I think that the exploration of space will be a very important part of it, because, as our dear friend Kraft Erika used to say, that maybe mankind needs the kind of what he called extraterrestrial imperative to give up the children sicknesses, the children diseases of irrationality and stupidity, because in space you have to behave in a certain rational way, because when you are in a spaceship, you just can't get out and take a walk and take a trip of LSD. You have to, you know, overcome these things. So I think, you know, I think we have to have a perspective of that we are now at a point where it is in our hands to make a new golden renaissance in which, you know, sure, there will be interdependence, but it will be an interdependence of a totally different nature as it was up to now. It will be an interdependence where we go to the kinds of relations among nations, as Schiller said in his famous writing, The Laws of the Lycurg from Sparta and The Laws of Solon from Athens, where he said that each nation should and must pursue its own national interest, but that these national interests can never and must never be in contradiction to the interest of mankind as a whole. And if we have that kind of a relation, then interdependence can become a very joyful collaboration for the common good.
Okay, thank you very much, Helga. We have several important brief announcements, so please wait 1 minute. We will take exactly an hour and restart the next session at 3:15. The hotel has announced that they're lowering the price on the sandwiches by a dollar. The audio tapes of this conference can be obtained from John Cavici at the booth in the back. Special rates are available if you purchase the whole conference. You can get separate panels, and there's on-site duplication, so you can take them home with you. A limited number of copies of Lyndon LaRouche's new music manual are available, one per family for ICLC members. National Center members should wait and pick them up tomorrow and let out-of-town people get them first. And one from Mel. Please wait a moment. Excuse me, one more. Regional coordinators, please see Nancy Premack or Marla Menachino in the staff room during the lunch or dinner breaks concerning attendance at the Cadre School. Okay, the Schiller Institute coalition call will, we hope to have it available for people to sign at the end of the next panel. We do have the Schiller Institute call for the immediate recognition of Croatian and Slovenian independence. On the coalition call to recognize the Triangle program as an important and essential element of world peace and stability, freedom, we intend to publish